BBC World Service.
Outlook. Introduced by John Tidmarsh. Hello and welcome to London. The roar of the lions. Are they eating into South Africa's policy of apartheid? We'll be looking at that first in today's programme. And we'll be recalling an invention that was first spoken about 100 years ago today, and something that today we perhaps can't do without. Tomorrow in South Africa, the British Lions rugby team play their final match, the fourth and last test. And if they win, they'll establish a record that can never be bettered. As you probably know, they've already won the test series, and victory tomorrow at Ellis Park, Johannesburg, will mean they've won every single game of the tour, 22 altogether. Even those who were strongly against the Lions tour of South Africa, and that includes the Prime Minister, Mr. Wilson, may now be having second thoughts about it. Though it was a breach of the almost universal policy, isolating South Africa from international competition as a protest against apartheid, the success of the Lions has been shattering for South Africa. After all, it's a country where, as I said to Colin Legum, rugby football sometimes seems more important than politics.
Well, as important as politics, perhaps more important than religion. And one doesn't say that as a light jest, because those of us who grew up in South Africa, as I did, I mean, were brought up on politics, but more important, we were brought up on rugby football. And the idea that the South Africans were not the greatest football players in the world was simply not an idea to be tolerated. And it becomes very important in a funny way for people to think of their greatness in certain terms. And when you get knocked off the pedestal, you really do get knocked in a way that is very hard to explain.
This is a symptom of their complete isolation now in the whole of sport, isn't it?
It is absolutely amazing, isn't it, the way the sport boycott of South Africa has grown. I mean, I remember when it started, the idea of a young coloured poet called Dennis Brutus, who had been shot and gone to Robben Island, you know, the prison island. And when he came out, this man in his lonely protest in Port Elizabeth decided that his contribution would be to bring about an international boycott of South Africa until they agreed to allow fully integrated sport. He loved sport. This is all he could do. He was write poetry and do sport. And this one man on his own started it. And you now have the situation that South Africa is debarred from the Olympic Games, debarred from international football, from international tennis, and cricket. The last two teams that will still play with it at football are France and Britain. And now Britain has whipped it so badly that it's left licking its wounds.
Throughout the British Lions tour, I understand that the black population of South Africa who've been at these matches have been cheering wildly for the British Lions. Now, do you think that this could possibly, in the end, their isolation in sport, bring down apartheid?
Well, I think there are two things to be said about it. The blacks, and really the blacks in this case are the coloureds, because although some blacks play football, they don't really. They play soccer, box, run. It's the coloureds, the people of mixed races, who play football and probably could get into a Springbok team. And they're the people who go and barrack, and they really are marvellous barracks. And the fact that they're always cheering the visiting side just shows this hostility inside the country, which is a symptom of the bitterness inside the country. And of course, this is intolerable to white South Africans, the open disloyalty of the non-white population who in their own eyes are terribly loyal to them, and yeah, they demonstrate their disloyalty. And so this becomes a very important political factor. The question now, you see, if they decide to ban the coloureds, the blacks, from spectator sport, as they're threatening to do, you see, how then can teams justify going along and not only playing against segregated teams, but playing before segregated audiences? The question, will it bring down apartheid? No, no. Apartheid, one must understand, as a system devised to maintain white supremacy, to maintain political power completely and totally in the hands of one-third of the population. And for this, the South Africans will stand a long way. They won't capitulate over sport. But what sport can do and has done is to introduce further ambiguities into the society. So apartheid demands a pure racially doctrined policy. And if you begin to cloud the issue in which, well, whites and blacks must be different, but in certain respects they can go together, then you take away the harshness of the doctrine and make it harder to defend. And this is what's been happening, you see, under the impact of sport. South Africans, for example, have now agreed that you can have what they call multinational sport in South Africa. That is, visiting teams can come, and they have a special international arena. And then blacks and whites and coloureds from South Africa can compete together against visiting teams. But where you have one team playing against South African side, then you don't have multinational sport, you then have racial sport. Now this is such a contradiction, you see. And of course the situation in South Africa is one full of internal contradictions. One should have a police state. One should have whites and blacks totally separated. One should have no blacks doing the jobs of whites and so on. It doesn't work out that way because society is developing too rapidly. It is too mixed up and so on. And it's these ambiguities, these internal contradictions, of which the pressures of sport is one, that I think will help to erode apartheid. And one is talking about erosion, not destruction.
I was talking to Colin Legum of The Observer. Fridays have been most enjoyable recently, certainly for me, and I hope for you, because we've always had a lot of music in the programme. And in compiling his musical atlas, A to Z, I find that Steve Race usually manages to include some piece I particularly like. I trust he maintains that record today, sorry about the pun, as he opens the atlas once more, this time at the letters U and V.
Which it's clear that the letter U in our musical atlas stands first for Utah, the state of Utah in America, and that splendid Mormon Tabernacle Choir, founded almost a century and a half ago. In those days, they were known as the Singing Saints, and their first choir director was, I'm happy to say, an Englishman, John Parry. When the Mormon wagon trains reached Salt Lake Valley in the summer of 1847, that song had yet to be written. Now, it's associated the world over with the famous Mormon Tabernacle Choir, the most famous choir, I suppose, in the world. So U is for Utah, also for Uganda, Uruguay, Uskadara, which Eartha Kitt used to sing about in her celebrated kitten voice, the Ukraine, and, come to think of it, the United Kingdom. It's not an expression we use here very much. We talk about Britain, the British Isles, but the United Kingdom, the UK, is something you hear more in Australia or Canada or New Zealand. But I'm told they have other names for us too. On then to the letter V. V for the Virgin Islands, where Duke Ellington made a memorable recording, and V for Valencia.
Valencia, in my dreams it always seems I hear you softly call to me. Valencia, where the orange trees forever scent the breeze beside the sea. Valencia, in my arms I held your charms beneath the blossoms high above. You loved me. In Valencia long ago we found a paradise of love.
Yes, that was a slightly elderly recording. Paul Whiteman's orchestra with Franklin Bauer singing in 1926. V, in any musical atlas, must stand for Venice, where, 2.5 centuries ago, when all the other serious composers were writing concerti and variations and fugues and preludes, one Antonio Vivaldi, known locally as Priest because of his flaming red hair, was calling his compositions The Barking Dog, or Sleeping Drunkards, Walking on the Ice, things like that. Not to mention naming them after young girls whom he fancied. By all means, call it Concerto No. 1 in E major, if you wish, said Vivaldi, in Italian. I prefer to call it Spring, La Primavera. And to make sure his listeners got the spring message, he gave his violinists the unmistakable voices of singing birds.
Thank you.